So I think, as I was mentioning yesterday, in this workshop, the real common thread to all the talks we've been hearing is exploration. And in the talk I will make today, I will try to illustrate that actually beyond the experiment in psychology and neuroscience that are studying certain forms of exploration, some of them we may like to call them curiosity, some of them we may not like to call them curiosity, that beyond those experiments that study certain forms of exploration, there is actually a jungle of mechanisms of exploration which is probably much wider than we could imagine if we don't take so much time to think about it. And so, I agree with Carl that one of the methods that can be used to try to improve our understanding of natural phenomena is to build machines. And sometimes building machines allow us to provide new kinds of answers to questions existing, but sometimes building machines also allow us to ask new questions. And I think that in the work I'm going to present, the main goal is to show that we understand even less about exploration and curiosity than we think we understand. Okay. So let's start by looking at examples of really great experiments that have been done in the past years to help us understand certain forms of exploration in children, in adults, and in animals like monkeys. Many of those experiments are based on a similar setup where you have subjects, so infants or adults or monkeys, which are looking at visual scenes. And the exploration we are looking at is basically the movement of their eyes on this visual scene. And then the kind of questions that are being asked are several. For example, what is the impact of visually observing certain surprising visual events on memorization? Other kinds of questions which are being asked are what are the neural correlates of visually observing or tracking certain kinds of surprising events as opposed to non-surprising events. Other related questions are not what are the neural correlates, but the behavioral correlates. So for example, in a recent study we did with Jacqueline, a setup very similar to the trivia questions we discussed yesterday, we were able to show that by looking at the low-level features of visual eye movements, we can actually predict what people report verbally when they are asked the questions how much you are curious about these questions, right? Okay. But now, what I would like to put my finger on in this talk is that this is only a very tiny part of the question we can ask about human exploration. And in particular, I would like that we consider spontaneous exploration as a more general question, and that beyond explorations through movements of the eyes towards external stimuli, we consider exploration of different kinds of actions with the body towards the external world. That beyond the concept of surprise, we consider other kinds of potential measure of interestingness. So by the way here, I think that also what I'm going to talk is mostly about the second part of the last slide of Peter. So Carl and Peter presented some kind of theoretical normative approach to how we can understand exploration in human beings. But once we have this framework, there is also the question of how these principles can be actually implemented in real organisms which have limited physical computational resources. And then as Peter was saying, we need hacks to have this work. And it is very important also to understand what are the hacks that are being used by humans, and also how we can use these hacks to build machines to do efficient exploration in the real world. And I think that here we need to go beyond the concept of surprise. And then I think we also need to consider the problem of exploration not only in short time scales, like experiments who are lasting a few minutes or hours in the lab, but really exploration on longer time scale, on a developmental time scale. So I'm going to try to formulate a number of open questions. So first kind of answer, if you look at the actual hacks or the proxies which are used by human brains to organize exploration, the question we can ask, even if we are in the framework of
visual exploration, but it applies also to other frameworks, as we'll see later on, is
what are the measures of interestingness that are used by the brain to heuristically organize its exploration. And then when we do mathematical or algorithmic modeling, we realize very quickly that there is a great diversity of potential mechanisms which actually may be incompatible with each other. For example, if you look at the very concept of novelty, which seems to be simple, but actually it is not so simple, because there are many ways to model novelty. One way is to say that novelty is the set of stimuli or events that are far away from what is already in memory. Another way is to model novelty as stimuli or events that are not well predicted by the brain. However, these two notions, they may appear similar if you type them like this, but they are not at all equivalent, because there can be stimuli that are far away from memory, which you have never seen, but which the brain is able to predict very well, because the brain has powerful extrapolation mechanisms, which from data you have seen in the past can allow you to predict data you have never seen, which is actually far from memory. And if you, for example, like implement a machine and tell it to organize exploration by searching and being interested to look at items which are novel, and you take one mathematical definition or the other, the behavior and the trajectory of exploration of this machine will be very different. And so beyond novelty, there are many measures that people have been looking at. Measures related to surprise, and there is not only Bayesian measures of surprise, but other kinds of measures of surprise. There are also concepts and measures related to, for example, knowledge gaps, intermediate novelty, intermediate complexity. So you might say instead of searching maximal complexity or novelty, you want some kind of intermediate level, and there are many ways to mathematically define this. Then there are notions like intermediate challenge, or a notion like learning progress, which is the speed of improvement of your prediction, which is a measure, for example, I've been playing with other colleagues like Jordan Schwedeberg. And I think that today we are just beginning to realize that it's really a big diversity of those methods that is existing. And actually, a few years ago, I did write a paper with my colleague Frédéric Caplan trying to systematically organize those measures in different families according whether they are Bayesian or not Bayesian, based on prediction on entropy, based on maximizing, minimizing something that is a different measure. And right now, if we look at the experiments that are existing in neuroscience and psychology, most of them are so simple that it is impossible to differentiate those different mechanisms. They all predict the same thing. And so I think that what we could do is try to invent new experimental paradigms that can be a bit more complex for studying the heuristics used by human brains or animal brains to organize exploration, and try to disambiguate those mechanisms. So one example, which is far from being perfect, but which is a first attempt a bit in this direction, is something we have tried with Jacqueline 2 or 3 years ago, is an experimental setup with human adults who can play a video game which is like the Guitar Hero PlayStation game. I don't know if you're familiar with that. You have notes appearing on the screen at a certain speed, and you need to touch the keys of your computer, like the piano keys, at the right time, at the right place to reproduce the tune. And in the standard Guitar Hero game, you begin by easy tune, and when you got it, the level is progressively increasing, and this goes like this. Here it's not like the way it goes. Here, right from the beginning, players are free to explore any level they want to explore. And so the levels are like little boxes on the screen. Sometimes there are not so many levels, sometimes more levels. And basically they are saying, you explore as you want, you're free, we are not going to measure your performance and compare it to other people, do just as you wish. And then what we try to study is how do they structure their exploration, okay? And for example, how much it is correlated to their current level of competence, to their level of progress, and how this can be influenced by various factors, such as the number of possible choices they can make, or for example, the fact that in some games there can be new tunes at a given level. And by doing this, for example, we could see that the many of the subjects would follow the following heuristics. They began by easy levels, and then they progressively increased, and quite often they discovered levels in the middle which
were too difficult for them, they could not solve them at all. Yet, they went even up the hierarchy and explored all the possible difficulties. Like, if they wanted to have some kind of idea of how much difficult it would be, even if they can't, they are very far from the user. And after this, they would come back to intermediate levels, not all the for all users, but intermediate levels, just like a bit beyond what they could do. And so, this is very primitive as a kind of result yet, but still, for example, it allows to, in this context, rule out heuristics such as go where your competencies or your uncertainty is maximum, because this is not what they do in the end. They are converging to something that is intermediate. Now, this setup is still limited. So, for example, for practical reasons, we could not really control the amount of learning progress that they could do. So, for example, we cannot differentiate in this setup a heuristic that drives exploration toward intermediate levels of complexity or that maximizes learning progress. But this is just to say that it's a step in the direction I think we should explore more. Okay, another open question, I'll be quick on that because I'll come later on, is what is the relation between active exploration and what some people are calling curiosity-driven exploration or attention and learning? And in some of the theoretical or experimental approaches that are existing, and for example that we have seen yesterday, for example in the book of Matthias Gruber, or where, for example, I guess we will hear a similar perspective in the talk of Liza Fagenson tomorrow, there is an idea which is studied, is to what extent being in a state of curiosity is facilitating memorization of learning. But it seems that there are computational models that exist which are actually modeling the mechanism that gives rise to the state of curiosity as something that is working by actually measuring the rate of learning itself. And so as a consequence, it means that the experiencing learning triggers curiosity, which has a feedback loop which facilitates memory. And this feedback loop is something that I think in current experiments with humans and animals is mostly unexplored. Okay, so now let's go to another kind of question. I just mentioned that one open question, one dimension about the active exploration method is what is the measure of interestingness? Another very important dimension is to what we apply this measure. And actually, there are many things to which we can apply this measure. So let's consider, for example, a setup where we have a baby robot, but I could have put here a human baby, and we can see this in this context. This robot has had in the past all the food he wants, all the social context he wanted. So he's really free to explore, and like a little scientist, he's going to try to make experiments to spontaneously explore and understand the world around it with several objects. And so, what are the choices that he can make to make sense and explore this space? So, in the experiments with humans and animals, typically the kind of choice we are looking at are the movements of his camera, or his eyes, and he's basically looking at different objects, waiting that they move, or waiting that someone else is moving them to see how they work. But of course, that's not all the only thing he can do. The first obvious thing he can do is use his arms and his body to take actions and to observe the effects on these objects. And so in that context, we come to the traditional framework of what's called active learning, machine learning, where the question is how to select the actions to be made to improve the prediction from the space defining the movements of its hand and the space of movements of a particular object, for example. But it's not the only kind of choice he can make, because instead of choosing actions to be made and observing the results, he could very well say, okay, let's put ourselves at a higher level, and we might select goals, like for example, he might say, I would like to explore how I can move this object on the right. And then, after selecting this goal, with one of the measures that we had before, except that it's not measuring, for example, prediction progress, but competence progress toward this goal, which is very similar to what Gianluca was mentioning. And so, instead of choosing action, he selects a goal and launches a low-level optimization mechanisms. And those goals, you can see them for the technical people here, as parameterized reinforcement learning problems, and you launch a low-level reinforcement learning procedure to reach those goals.
But by the way, those rules, they could be defined in several spaces. For example, they could concern effects on different kinds of objects. So you might consider not only one space of goal, but several spaces of goals. And you might, of course, want to decide, what am I going to explore? Am I going to explore what kind of effects it can produce on this type of object or on this other type of object? And so here, basically, what you have to choose is which model you want to work on, to explore. And this is what we are going to call model exploration or model babbling. And then those models, they are not all necessarily flat and independent of each other. At some point for exploration, there could be representational learning, which makes that robot discover that there is a hierarchy between those models. And so, for example, if you have the robot deciding, I want to move the yellow object here, am I going to try to improve my control of this yellow object using directly my hand? Or am I going to practice how to move this object by moving another object as an intermediate proxy? And so this is another kind of thing that can be chosen, is the path that is used to explore. And then, of course, in the world, there is not only one being, there are other social beings. And those social beings can be asked for help. And so a kind of choice of this little robot as a scientist is, do I, in the next 10 minutes, do I continue to try alone, or do I ask help to a human? And which kind of question do I ask to a human if I ask help to him? Okay. And so, for all these kind of things, there are algorithms that are existing. In my group, we've been working on many different families of algorithms to try to find out how to do those things at the same time. And one kind of experimental setup that we've been using to test those ideas, and that I will use here rather to illustrate what it means in practice. So let's consider a robot fisher. And this robot fisher is a little scientist trying to understand how this object, which is the fishing rod, is working, and how moving this can allow to, for example, put the red float here in various places of the environment. So initially, it knows nothing about the relation between its movements and the trajectories of this red float. And basically, there are a number of choices it will have to make to decide how to make experiments. The first level of choices you can make is by deciding which goals you will try to reach, like where you want to put the red float around. But another kind of thing that you can decide is that, as you just saw, there are humans around who can come and, for example, show a movement to the robot by physically taking it, and then the robot can observe what is being done. And it happens that in this case there are not only actually one human, but several humans which can help. Some of them are good, some of them are bad. It's very easy to find bad fishers in a PhD student lab. Actually, most are bad, but there are some which are even better than the others. And the thing is that how this robot is working is through hierarchical bonding mechanism, by trying to sample the possible choices. And for example, do I try alone or do I try by asking people? He samples those choices and he measures, for example, in that case, how much progress in improving its model it is providing. And then if it is choosing the self-exploration, then it's going to have to choose which goals you want to practice. If it's choosing asking help, then which teacher I have to choose, and each teacher is a bonding machine if you want, and the reward being the learning progress provided by the machine. And then if he selects a teacher, and the teacher showing something, he can actually select, what do I do with the information? Do I try to mimic the movements? Which is not very easy, because he has parameterized movements such that he cannot copy exactly the movements of the human. Or do I try to emulate the goal with its current repertoire of action policies? And this is going to lead to different experiments and different data. And so he has to choose again what to do. Okay, let's go to another open question that is mostly unexplored, I think, with humans and animals. So what are the consequences of short-term active exploration mechanisms that we observe in the lab for a few minutes if they are unrolled and being on for weeks, months, and even more? And I think that what I'm going to show is that those local spatial-temporal mechanisms of active exploration, they can self-organize in the long-term developmental trajectories in a way that's quite interesting for our understanding aspects of development. When I say self-organization, what do I mean? So let's take a completely different world, the physical world. When I say self-organization, I'm denoting properties of some systems where at the local level, so for example, if you look at water molecules, at the local level, there are some symmetries and some structures, but then in certain conditions of temperatures and pressure, there is a macro structure which is appearing at a higher spatial and temporal scale, where it's not very easy to directly find the same symmetries. Okay? And so one of the ideas is that there are some of the mechanisms that are at play at short time and spatial scale in active exploration, or curiosity-driven exploration. When you look at them at a much longer time scale, you see that they are generating very fascinating forms of behavior. And so now I'm going to discuss a model to explore this idea, and it's based on a predictive brain framework. And so here, basically, we have a child, or a robot, as we will see in the experiment, which decides actions. And then before it makes actions on the wall, it tries to make predictions about their consequences. Then he actually makes the actions, and he observes the consequences. And by comparing the actual consequences with its prediction, it's computing a measure of prediction error that is used to update its predictive model of the world. So far, so good, very classical. So now the question is, what is the mechanism that is used to decide which actions to make? And here, the child is modeled as a kind of little scientist that tries to select actions or experiments, if you wish, that are going to maximize its gaining information about the world dynamics. So one way, there are many ways to do that, okay? Many ways to do that. One way to do that, which has been proven to be a very good proxy for working in high-dimensional continuous spaces that robots face, which are quite often similar to the one infants have, is basically to add on top of the prediction machinery another machine which basically monitors how much predictions improve for various kinds of actions and various kinds of context or various kinds of activities. And such improvement of prediction is something that we can call learning progress. And this measure of learning progress in this model is going to be used as the reward that an action selection mechanism is going to use and will try to maximize. And this action selection mechanism is typically a bounded mechanism, as we have been hearing in other talks. And so basically, it means that at any point in its development, the model is mainly focusing on exploring activities that are sources of learning progress. And this is interesting because these activities, in practice, are the ones that are neither too easy, not too difficult. And this basically models the idea that what the brain finds interesting to practice is what is just beyond the current level of competencies, what is of intermediate level of complexity. And this is very much, this is a very precise mathematical formulation, but if you look at what it is doing, it is very much compatible with many vague ideas formulated in development psychology, like the intermediate complexity of Berlin. And it's also compatible with recent experimental evidence, such as what we observe in the experiment with the Guitar Hero game I presented with, that we did with Jacqueline earlier, or recent results by the group of Celeste kids with human infants, showing that they prefer observing certain kinds of external stimuli of intermediate complexity. Okay, and so we can run those mechanisms on actual physical robots. One of those experiments is called the playground experiments, and basically illustrates how such mechanisms of active exploration can dynamically interact with the learning mechanisms and also with the physical and social constraints, and can actually self-organize developmental trajectories, and in particular to discover successively things like object affordances and basic skills for vocal interaction between the learner and its kids. And so in these experiments, as you see behind me, there is a robot in the middle that is placed in an infant's play mat with a series of nearby objects. And among these objects, there is an adult robot. And what is quite important that you understand is that when you look at this scene, you project a lot of prior knowledge that you as human have. This robot does not have this knowledge. For this robot in the middle, the world is a black box. And what it can do is send numbers in boxes that are what we call motor primitives, that are going to produce movements of the body, but it has no idea what is the map of his body and what kind of movement it's producing. It's just motor commands. And then it has sensory primitives, which detect things like moving objects, colors, properties of sounds, touches,
proprioceptive things like things in the mouse. But again, for this robot, these are just numbers for me out of black boxes. And he does not know at all the relationship between those numbers in the motor space and those numbers in the sensory space. So just, this is very important because this robot does not have all the prior knowledge that you have when you look at this scene. And so basically, among those objects, the adult robot is also a bit special because it's pre-programmed to imitate the sound of produced by the robot in the center. So now we don't have sound, but the robot in the center is producing sound actually that we could hear if we would have sound. And the other robot is responding to these sounds by imitating them with a different fundamental frequency when the robot in the center is producing sound and looking at this robot at the center. Okay, so to summarize again, so the robot really learns by conducting experiments. It tries action, it observes effects. And then it's going to detect regularities between these actions and these effects. And the way it selects actions is by sampling with higher probability the one which have provided learning progress in the past. So to be more precise, it's actually categorizing progressively the continuous sensory motor space in different subregions which group similar kinds of motor experiments. And even if you do that motor experiments precisely somewhere and learns in one shot the consequence of this motor experiment, in average, in a local region of the sensory motor space, is going to be able to monitor how much it improves in predicting those kinds of actions. And so through generalization, it will be able to go for new kinds of actions and new kinds of contexts by expecting learning progress based on the fact that he has experienced learning progress in similar kinds of actions and contexts in the past. Okay, and so in these experiments,
well, it's okay, it's not a big issue. Thank you very much.
So in these experiments, in the end, what do we observe? So basically what we observe is that the robot learns to manipulate and to interact with several objects in front of him. Like he learns how to grasp the object which is in front of him, he learns how to provoke certain kinds of vocal responses in the other robots, he learns how to push in certain ways other objects. But these skills were not specifically encoded as reward functions that are specific to moving those objects. They were learned as a side effect of the global exploration of the robot to make a model, a good model of the world. And also, what is interesting is the robot is able to spontaneously evolve and self-organize its behavior with progressive increase in complexity. Actually, what we see is the appearance of certain cognitive stages which are not pre-programmed. So for example, after beginning relatively slow, relatively random body balancing, the robot is focusing on moving the legs around to predict how it can touch objects. Then it's going to focus on grasping an object with its mouth. And for example, for doing this, it has to combine concurrently several of its motor primitives involving the legs and involving the movements of the mouse. And finally, it ends up exploring vocal interaction with the other robot. It does that typically in an ordered and visible way. And this ordering, the nature of those stages, their timing, was not pre-programmed by the engineer made this robot. The trajectory is actually self-organizing to the dynamic interaction between heuristical exploration, the biases of the statistically informed machinery, the properties of the body and the properties of the environment, which by their physical properties define and constrain the landscape of potential learning progress that is existing here. And so basically, these experiments do not simply simulate particular skills, but they simulate really an ordered and systematic developmental trajectory with a with a stage-like structure that is regularly appearing across simulation that could be taken to indicate an internally driven maturational process for an external observer, but which is not. It is really the emergent result of the interaction of those internal processes with the physical properties of the world. And it's quite interesting also, I won't go into that, but it may have some evolutionary implication in the sense that such mechanisms that allow an organism to acquire skills and to solve problems before they are actually needed in the world might be quite advantageous
And this is also compatible with the work of some people like the group of Satinder Singh and Andrew Barton, who made experiments with simulated robots where what they evolve is reward functions, where with the goal to really maximize fitness, so there is a precise extrinsic fitness to be maximized, but the result of the evolutionary process is that it pre-programs intrinsic reward functions which look like what is in this kind of machines. And because these are self-organizing processes, they generate not only strong regularities, but also here we observe diversity across individual developmental trajectories. So the same mechanism, the same initial parameters, make that while they are the same parameters, individual trajectories across individuals may be different sometimes. Sometimes it's just only details, but sometimes there are big differences. Some stages are inverted, or some new stages, new skills are acquired by a particular robot, which no other robot has acquired. And this is basically due to stochasticity, to small variability in the physical reality, and to the fact that these developmental dynamics are several attractors with more or less extended domains of attraction. And so this is why I showed here the famous picture by Waddington about the epigenetic landscape, because the way the behavior of a trajectory is forming in these experiments is a bit like this ball rolling down the mountain, and little contingencies, the fact, for example, that at some point, by chance, the robot has explored a little bit more one activity than the other, makes it discover some representation or regularity, which is going to allow him to discover that he can learn even more in this direction, and it will make a snowball effect. And he will explore more these things and be interested more in this thing than the other thing. And this actually relates to the snowball effect that I think yesterday we saw, maybe it was in Kuz's talk, which is really what we see here. Okay, here is another related experiment where one studies how the exact same kind of mechanism can participate to structure vocal development, so the exploration of sound that can be produced by the vocal tract. And so here there is an additional mechanism with the playground experiments I mentioned, which is actually common to the fishing experiments I presented before, is that here not only the robots can decide to explore by itself how its vocal tract movement can produce sounds, but is also able to look at the sounds produced by social peers and to decide when he might try to imitate those sounds. And so here, of course, we have a physical model of the vocal tract in simulation. We don't have a real physical vocal tract, a model of the motor control and of the auditory system. And basically here we see again a self-organization of vocal phases. So, for example, within an initial self-exploration phase, the following sequence appears. So the vocal learner first discovers how to control phonation. So actually most movements of the vocal tract don't produce sound at all, it's already a stage. The milestone to discover this, and it does this in the first stage. Then it focuses on vocal variations of unarticulated sounds, which are things like things like this. And then finally automatically discovers and focuses on babbling articulated protosyllables, which means inserting stops in between this, which is bra, ba, bam, things like this. And as the vocal learner becomes more proficient at producing complex sounds, imitation of vocalization of peers start to provide learning progress. Initially, actually, he tries to sample the task of, I'm going to try to imitate those sounds. But they are so complicated in the sense that he does not already have the basic motor structure, the basic Lego block, if you want to make progress about them, that he does not make progress initially. So with the bandit he has in his head, he samples this, he sees no learning progress, and so he keeps that at a very low probability. But later on, after he has self-explored his vocal sounds for a while, he has learned those building blocks, and now when he tries again to imitate the sound of the vocal peers, he can actually make progress because he has the toolkit for making progress. And this is why now he is focusing on this. And what is interesting is that this progression within the self-exploration phase from unarticulated sound to protos levels, and from self-exploration to babbling influenced by the sounds of the social peers, is also what we observed in human infants. As for example shown by David Waller, in the first phase, like until the canonical babbling stage, there is a lot of structure that we observe that is very much similar to what we observe here. And so just to conclude, in fact, it's 2 minutes, great. Just to conclude, 2 minutes, so far, I mostly talked about several issues, like, okay, the space of potential mechanisms for exploration is very large. We have a lot experimented in machines, but so far the space of those mechanisms is studied in humans and animals is very small. Another thing I said is that those mechanisms, if you look at them on the long time scale and not on the short time scale, they generate very important and strong structural developmental patterns, which I think may help to understand some of the organization of learning curriculum or developmental phases we observe in children. But the last thing is that I just wanted to say that these mechanisms are also extremely efficient for actually learning skills that an engineer wants the robots to learn, but are difficult to learn. An example is, for example, learning how to locomote. So take this example of a robot, which the engineer wants this robot to learn how to move around by oscillating its leg. And it's very complicated because these are the moped and it is sleeping everywhere. So there are many movements to produce results that are quite complicated to predict. And by using the architecture I presented to you, in one afternoon this robot, like 2 or 3 hours, this robot learns how to locomote and to coordinate its legs to make all the translation and rotations that you can imagine in the short term. And basically, if you compare the speed at which it can learn these inverse control capacities, like if you're giving it a target translation and rotation and finding adequate policies, if you compare doing this with random exploration and active exploration, and with random exploration you might reach the good skills in a very long time, but it will really take a lot of time. Whether in just a few hours this robot will learn how to walk. And actually, I'm just going to take another example about why those intrinsic motivation or active exploration mechanisms searching for learning progress, novelty, or whatever can be useful for very practical engineering problems. So you know that here there is a community of people machine learning trying to develop very advanced reinforcement learning mechanisms, and one of the benchmarks they are using is Atari games. And those Atari games, they take the machines and they want the machine to solve those games by working from the raw pixel level. So that's very difficult. That's really very difficult for those machines. And with a number of, for example, deep reinforcement learning algorithms, those algorithms can solve those games. But for some of the games, the traditional reinforcement learning approach, where the only reward you consider is the number of points, is very difficult. And why it is very difficult is because the reward is very rare or it's deceptive. And then it means that if you do random exploration, there is very little probability that you find an information that gives you a little hint to know in what direction or what you need to do to maximize this reward. And so what people are doing is that they add another component to the reward function, which is very similar to the notion of exploration bonus that Peter has been talking about, but then there are many complicated issues of how to make this really work in complicated spaces. And then with that, actually, you have those systems that can really solve difficult games that cannot be solved without explicitly putting this in the algorithm. Thank you very much.
So, when you use the word exploration, in my head, that is something which is very open, literally explorative. Is there a point at which the questions start to become more closed in order to develop the learning process? So, and can I just add a supplement to that? So, if the answer is yes, which I think might be the same in science, is it the same for all learning in other subjects as well?
Okay, so I'm not sure I completely understand your question, but here, when I talk about exploration in those experiments and modeling with robots, it's extremely precise. It's basically in those experiments, okay, if you want, the goal of the system is to make a good predictive or control model of the world. So that's really a goal that is very similar to the goal of the system of car. And then the question is, how do you decide which actions or which experiments to make in that world to gain useful information that's going to improve your model such that at a maximum speed, which is what you want to do, you will actually have a good model of the world. And so exploration is the problem of how you experiment in that world.
I'm wondering whether the uncertainty reduction and the maximization of the learning progress assumes that the agent is already active in the environment. But what is So you say at some point that the first steps of the exploration were basically like the robots by default. I had the feeling that the robot by default was active and then was finding.
Yeah, okay, so to reformulate that another way. Here, the goals of the systems is to maximize future expected learning progress, for example. Okay? And to solve, and this is a very traditional reinforcement learning problem that you can see, the reward being a bit more original in the sense that it's not about getting money or points, but learning progress. Okay? And if you use a very standard algorithm for doing this, by default, to maximize this, as Peter, by the way, explained very well, they will generate exploration. And so here you have several levels of exploration. And so indeed, there is, in the system from the start, mechanisms for doing those movements. Because if it does nothing, it will receive no rewards.
Okay.
No learning progress, so he has to do something.
And is there any formulation of boredom in those learning robots and in those optimal or normative models?
Okay, so that's... it depends the way you see that question. Because you could, if you take the point of view of modeling emotional states, you could probably use the same signals. For example, you could use the properties of the curve of the evolution of errors in prediction or control performances. And then, for example, when you detect that you're reaching a plateau in a certain activity, this is triggering some kind of chemical process that is making it not only not interesting, but it is making it aversive in a way. But doing this is not going to help those systems algorithmically. So an open question is, can we find interesting functions of boredom? And I do not have an answer.
So, maybe my first question is related to that. So how much learning progress is good and how is already deciding how much they need to have to stay on a particular task? And I have a question about memory. So to keep track of learning, you need to have memory, and that some humans don't have a lot. So how do you do that?
Yeah, so the measures I've been mentioning, they are used concurrently for several things. They are used for deciding whether the organism is staying on the current activity or abandoning it. Okay, and this is your question. And this measure is a measure of learning progress, basically. But when it's deciding to abandon it, in a way, it has also to choose which new one is going to explore. And we are in a continuous world, not only a discrete world. And so activities have continuous features. And the thing is that based on the learning progress he has experienced in the past on certain activities with certain features, then he will generate potential activities in its head that it could consider with certain features or which are available physically around it. And then based on the similarities of these activities with what other activities experienced in the past, he will kind of make a prediction of the potential expected learning progress. And this is what also will help him decide to go for it. But maybe when he goes for it, he discovers, in the end, maybe not as providing as much learning progress as predicted. So with the bounded algorithm, it will just shift to something else. I don't remember the side of the question. Because my working memory was close. So that was the working memory question. Yes. So yes, you're entirely right. An open question is to what extent those mechanisms, if this is really a hypothesis for those things. If they would exist, if some families or flavors of this exist in the brain of animals Of course, they are probably modulated by a number of factors, and working memory is obviously a very important factor.
Yeah.
I have a question, maybe it's good for the later discussion. So this morning we have seen two approaches to modeling gradient here. One is derived from general principles. This is the approach of Carl and Peter. Deriving from general principles, trying to unify concepts at a very high level. And then we have this other approach that is yours and mine that looks at specific experiments, specific details about the brain, and comes up with these lower level principles, and these principles are dirty, there are many, and there is a lot of confusion over there. So it seems to me that there is a big gap between these two types of approaches. So is there any hope to bridge the gap, and how could we do that?
Okay, so you're spoiling my introduction to the discussion this afternoon. No, so that's a very good question. So, but I propose that we discuss that in the afternoon.
Okay, I agree with that. Yeah, that's a great idea. Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you.